But it's cold outside.
It may be cold outside, but that won't stop the Syracuse softball team from competing. For now, the ladies take warm weather getaways almost every weekend to play early season tournaments. Playing 30-plus road games before ever stepping foot on your home field can be tough, but rewarding.
So traveling takes a real toll on us. We miss a lot of school. We miss a lot of work. We have a lot of catching up to do when we come back. But it's always wonderful to see, to be outside for the first time.
Although your first 30 games on the road, you get to go see a lot of cool cities versus if you were able to play at home, you're staying in Syracuse. And although that would be great, we use it as a recruiting advantage that we get to go to different cities all the time.
Coach Lee Ross says the Syracuse softball field won't be ready for play or practice probably until mid-March, which means the ladies have moved inside the Carrier Dome, though they say finding a home inside the dome isn't much of a problem.
Practicing indoors, we can get mostly everything we want done. I mean, this game is about throwing, catching, and hitting, and we're able to do most of that here at the dome.
I would say that we have one of the best facilities in the country. We have a really big space. We can set up a field pretty much any time that we have 50 yards. So it's kind of like we can run through anything full field at any point in time during practice.
The softball team hasn't shown any ill effects yet from the travel or indoor practices, as the Cuse is off to its best start since 2005. Maybe it isn't too cold outside. Jameson Fleming, NCC Sports. A new coach and a hometown hero leading the huddle has Syracuse football fans filling the Carrier Dome again. 40,000 people are packing the dome to see Doug Marone's revamped football team and local star Greg Paulus play QB. The players are loving it.
We never felt the dome like that since I've been here. You know, I just hope the support stays with us and we can show them and give them what they deserve.
2 weeks later, Carter and the Orange delivered on his promise.
The crowd helped us out a lot, you know, it was a big help, and it felt good, you know, being in that type of atmosphere. So I think this home stretch, you know, with the six games, you know, is going to be a great thing for us.
I know for a fact the dome's going to be rocking, you know, and I can't wait. You know, the fans have been tremendous and been, like, awesome, very supportive. I can't wait to come back out and just fill the dome up.
Despite the players' appreciation for the fans in the stands and the higher attendance number, students still aren't filling up the section behind the end zone and this one right here along the sideline. And that stumps the Carrier Dome's Pat Campbell.
The numbers are down significantly for students for football. And we met today and we're trying to figure out why that's the case. We're sort of baffled.
4 years of abysmal football may have something to do with the attendance, but Marone is a man of tradition, and tradition may keep the students coming back.
The fight song and alma mater, it's something that's individual to our school, just like the national anthem is to the United States. Having the players come over is an amazing thing. You know, it shows win or lose, we stick together as a team and a student section.
Campbell's solution, more fans means a better chance to win, and more wins means more fans. Jameson Fleming, NCC News. Welcome back to NCC News. I'm Jameson Fleming. The Orange men's basketball team gets to defend its sixth place ranking with a tough neutral site game against fellow undefeated Florida. Even without star guard Nick Calathes, the Gators are much improved since SU knocked off the Gators last year. Florida already has an impressive win over last year's runners-up, Michigan State. Billy Donovan's team doesn't possess the ability to shoot the Cuse out of its zone, as Florida's two most frequent three-point shooters are a combined 28% from long range. Tip-off in Tampa is set for 9 p.m. Connecticut and Kentucky tipped off last night in the first half of the Big East SEC Invitational. The Huskies wanted to end a three-game losing streak to ranked teams in Madison Square Garden, but the Wildcats had other ideas. Led by the spectacular John Wall, John Calipari's club was looking for its second consecutive victory over a top 15 team. Kentucky got off to a 12-0 lead, but UConn battled back to make it a game. Kemba Walker, two of his 12 points, gives the Huskies a 61-60 lead. But John Wall, just give him an NBA contract right now, as that is a move that deserves to be in the league, gives Kentucky a 62-61 lead. Connecticut trying to answer. It's Walker again, floater in the lane, no good. Kentucky brings down the board. Ramon Harris gets fouled. He'll go to the free throw line. He'll make one of two, misses the second. Connecticut comes the other way. Kemba Walker gets trapped on the sideline, forced to give it up to eventually Gavin Edwards, who was hot in this game, but not right here. He misses the shot. Kemba Walker flies in for the rebound. He has a chance at it. He can't hit it. Kentucky wins 64-61. Another Big East ranked team playing against St. Joe's. Villanova. Scotty Reynolds just dribbles around until he finds his shot. He drills three of his 22 points. Nova up 32-23, but St. Joe's battles back. Will take the lead as Darren Govins hits the layup, 38-37. The Hawk never dies, but they wilted in this game as Taylor King hits two late threes to put Nova up seven. They eventually go on to win 97-89. And Dominican Sue continues to make his case for the Heisman after winning the Lombardi Trophy as the nation's best lineman. Sue says he recognizes the significance of this award.
I mean, it's one of the top awards in the country, as I've seen myself. And as far as I'm concerned, Vince Lombardi, it just speaks volumes just by saying his name. And being able to be a part of him and have any kind of recollection, being a part of his name is just huge.
Sue is a finalist for the Heisman Trophy. He's the first defensive player since Charles Woodson in 1997 to be in contention for the award. The players joining Sue in New York for the award ceremony Saturday will be running backs Toby Garrett of Stanford and Mark Ingram of Alabama, as well as Texas QB Colt McCoy and Florida's Tim Tebow. Moving on to a sport where the athletes already get paid on the ice, the floundering Rangers badly needed a victory against a surging Blackhawks team, which sits in first place. We'll pick it up in the first period. The Rangers, they get the first goal early on as Christopher Higgins puts the Rangers on the board 1-0. But the well goes dry for the Rangers as Chicago finally gets on the board themselves after a few cracks at the net. Jonathan Toews ties the game with 6 minutes left. It will go to overtime, and Dustin Byfuglien, with a breakaway, he will find the back of the net to give Chicago a 2-1 win and sends the Rangers home with another loss. Buffalo taking on the Capitals. Lindy Ruff getting his team motivated early on, and it worked as Steve Montador from the blue line 4 minutes in gives the Sabres a 1-0 lead later on in the second period. Nathan Gerby will put the Sabres up 2-0 on the power play. Buffalo continues to pour it on, this time on a 4-on-4. Henrik Tillander gets his rebound. He scores 3-0, and that lead will stand behind Ryan Miller as Miller pitches his 16th shutout of his career. Buffalo wins 3-0.